3, Energy, Chemical Reactions, and Cellular Respiration, Part 1. Energy. Energy is the capacity to do work. That is the official definition of energy. And energy exists in two main states. That is either as potential energy being stored energy, where the ability to do work is fixing to happen. Isn't happening? Fixing to happen, stored energy. So a balloon filled with air, it's fixing to release that air, but not yet. And then kinetic energy is the energy of motion, the energy of things happening. So release your hold on the opening to the balloon and the air rushes out, causing the balloon to move. Energy can be converted from one state to another. So for instance, we use the example of a dam as shown down here. All the water being held back by the dam, that water has lots of potential energy. It is fixing to overflow the dam and produce kinetic energy. So when that stationary water moves through the structures of the dam to pass through the dam, that is kinetic energy, and that energy can be harnessed to do work. In this case, to spin turbines to generate electricity. In our plasma membranes of our cells, the structure that surrounds cells, it is possible to have kinetic energy by having what's called a concentration gradient. This is where there's a lot of a substance on one side of the membrane and not very much on the other side. So high concentration on one side, low concentration on the other side, usually something that cannot pass through the membrane easily. So example over here, sodium ions high on one side, on the outside, low on the inside. And that is potential energy. And then when you have certain areas, certain, say, protein structures that form a channel that allows sodium to cross the membrane, going from high to low, that is turning that potential energy from that gradient into kinetic energy. And the movement of the sodium ions into the cell can be used to do work of one kind or another. So electrons from atoms can move from one energy shell to another. So if you remember, atoms have many electron energy cells on the outside, and it turns out the electrons don't have to stay at the lowest level possible. They can actually be pushed up through the gain of energy to higher energy shells. And then when they bounce down to those lower shells, that potential energy from the higher shell gets released as kinetic energy that can then be used to do some sort of work. And in our cells, this can be used, for instance, to form ATP molecules. ATP molecules, very important. They are the energy currency of our cells, the chemical that our cells use to perform a lot of important functions. So, chemical energy. Chemical energy is a form of potential energy. It is stored within the bonds, the chemical bonds of the molecule. So for instance, here we have, as our substrate, we have a triglyceride. It has a bunch of bonds holding it all together. Also got some water. And then when a chemical reaction occurs, breaking those bonds, giving us the glycerol and three fatty acids, this is going to release energy. So breaking those bonds in the triglyceride will form energy that can be turned into ATP and used by the cell. So breaking bonds produces energy. Electric energy is just the movement of charged particles. When we talk about electricity in our walls, that kind of electricity is the movement of electrons, which we know are negatively charged. But for cells, the movement is of ions, of charged atoms, often moving across the plasma membrane. So for instance, the sodium ions moving across the membrane. Mechanical energy is objects in motion. Mechanical energy is things being able to move and then moving. Great example is the heart. The heart is able to contract to force blood out through the various arteries. So it's the pumping, the movement of the heart's muscles that lead to circulation of our blood throughout the body. Sound energy is basically molecular compression, increasing the density of molecules in a certain area. and those compressed molecules will then hit other things as it tries to expand again, causing that object to vibrate. So sound waves travel down the ear canal and collide into the eardrum. And that is the beginning of the process of hearing. So sound energy, compression, and then release of that compression, leading to, say, the vibration of something. Radiant energy. Radiant energy is energy of electromagnetic waves. So light, for instance, is a form of electromagnetic waves. So visible light can be detected by our retinal cells. The energy of the visible light can then be turned into electric energy in the neurons, energy, neural impulse. And heat. Heat is another form of kinetic energy. Heat is random motion. Usually we are unable to make anything useful happen from the heat. However, we can find ways to make it useful. So for instance, heat is used to give us a temperature, our body temperature. So we spend a lot of energy trying to maintain the proper body temperature because that's the temperature that most of the things in our body work better at. All right, energy again can change form. The retinal cells can turn light energy into electrical energy of the nerve impulse. Chemical energy in food can be turned into other kinds of chemical energy, often ATP. And ATP then can be used for mechanical energy, for the energy of things moving. So energy can change forms. Here, for instance, lovely glycogen, long chains of glucose. When you break the chemical bonds and form the individual glucose molecules, that's a way of forming energy. And then, of course, using glucose, breaking it down, can lead to even more energy being produced in the form of ATP. Thermodynamics, study of those energy transformation. First law of thermodynamics, energy can neither be created nor destroyed, can only change form. Makes sense. Second law of thermodynamics, when energy changes form, some energy is lost as heat. That means no matter what happens, when you change the form of energy, you're going to lose some of it to heat. And for us, again, because we want to keep our body temperature at around 37 degrees Celsius, we can take advantage of the second law of thermodynamics by, say, moving around when we're cold, and that will help to warm us up because, again, some of that mechanical energy will be turned into heat. Because chemical energy becoming mechanical energy, we're also going to get heat produced. Chemical equations. Chemical equations have reactants or substrates on one side, an arrow that then points to the product. So you start with the reactants, things happen during the arrow, and you get the products. Again, the arrow points to the products. Catabolism. Catabolism, also known as decomposition reactions, often involving water, the breaking of water, hydrolysis. Catabolism is the thing of taking a bigger thing and breaking it down into smaller things. So this decomposition reaction is a type of catabolism. Take sucrose, add water, break it into glucose and fructose. Water, A and B, becomes A plus B. Anabolism, adding things together, is types of synthesis reactions, often dehydration reaction. So often water is produced during this process. So we have two amino acids. They get bound together in the process. Water is lost, leading to a dipeptide, that peptide bond between the two amino acids. So A plus B becomes product AB. Some water is also produced. So water is also a product in this case. Catabolism cuts them up. Anabolism adds them together. Exchange reactions. Exchange reactions are when parts of two different chemical or one, some parts of something is going somewhere else, exchanging, moving from one side to another. So creatinine phosphate and ADP can become creatinine and ATP by the movement of a phosphate group from creatinine phosphate to the ADP. So AB plus CD becomes products AD plus CB. Oxidative reduction reactions are a little more complicated, but they involve the movement of electrons from one structure to another, and they can be moved alone or with hydrogen ions. So here NAD plus can gain electrons while the same process gaining hydrogen, and then that can be used later on. This is Oxidative reductive reduction reactions, very important for aerobic cellular respiration. That's about all we're going to talk about that. All right, so for instance here, we have two monosaccharides, and they become a disaccharide in water. Is it catabolism or anabolism? Is it hydrolysis or dehydration? What are the products? What are the substrates? You, of course, knew the answers to that, right? I hope so. All right, you can also classify chemical reactions by whether they're exergonic reactions or endergonic reactions. Exergonic means the reactants have more energy than in their chemical bonds in the products. So more energy in the reactants, less in the products. That energy is not destroyed, it is released, and in some cases can be used to make ATP. Endergonic reactions, the reactants have less energy than the products. That means energy has to be added to get this reaction to happen. So this would need ATP. ATP cycling is where you're combining exergonic reaction and an endergonic reaction to basically keep moving ATP from its triphosphate form, ATP, to its diphosphate form, ADP. So basically gains electron and energy, loses the energy in the phosphate group, gains the phosphate group, but needs energy, gets rid of that energy, and loses the phosphate group. So this can be occurring in our cells all the time. Irreversible chemical reactions cannot go backwards. Substrates lead to products. That is it. Reversible reactions, you can bounce backwards and forwards between the reactants and the products. Normally, they find a balance in the amounts of reactants and the amounts of products. You can then disrupt that balance, disrupt that equilibrium by disturbing it. So if you add more reactants, you will cause a push toward making more products. Or if you decrease the amount of products, that will also drive the equation, drive it to the right to the formation of more products. So add more reactants or get rid of the products, that will lead to more products being formed. And of course, the reverse, decrease the reactants, remove reactants, or increase the products, add more products, that will drive it to the left, that will drive it to the formation of the reactants. And this can be useful in some biological processes. So, for instance, carbon dioxide is being produced by our cells all the time. It ends up going into the bloodstream. That happens. It reacts with water and forms carbonic acid. So we have a certain level of that occurring. They form an equilibrium balance. Except, wait. There is another step where the carbonic acid then loses a hydrogen to form bicarbonate and a hydrogen ion. So we have these different reactions occurring at the same time, forming an equilibrium between all of them. This occurs in our blood to help maintain blood pH. So this is a pretty important process. And that is it for this part of the lecture.